somewhere between here and Granby High School, I guess, and Paul will be here. So why don't we begin the agenda overview, and then we'll do council interest real quickly, and then we'll jump into scope renovations.
Sure. Okay, Mayor and members of council, the first order of business is that we're going to delay the scope renovations. I'm sorry, John. He was going for the all-time record. So we'll have an update on that, as well as two additional updates, the arts district and food trucks. And lastly, we'll have our first discussion with the council on a follow-up with education. So we'll lay out some of the issues that have been presented to us over the last few weeks and get guidance from you what other areas you'd like for us to cover. So, Mayor, with that said.
Okay. Mr. Wynn.
You and I talked about the coffee shop at Cure. Have you, we forwarded you that. They were having a very frustrating time getting their building permits to, and they were told 2 weeks and then 3 weeks. And
over
then
Freemason.
Over right. Freemason.
Ron is him.
What does that mean?
That there's more to it than just the email.
I understand there were some problems.
He admits that he started building it before he had the permits.
Right.
But his point is that, it was like several days after he was told his permits were going to get here. There's two sides of the story, clearly.
Right.
But this is a guy who is a business owner here in the city that we want to try to, help him. He's been shut down for a while. We don't have to do it right now,
right?
Okay, but maybe we could get some, maybe you could put it in writing or something to us. I'm actually meeting with the guy tomorrow.
What bothers me worse, I guess, than anything is, we tell somebody I'll have this in 2 weeks, and then you go back, and another week, and then they go back, and I can't tell you exactly when it's going to be. So, that's not...
Mr. Mayor, if I could, they did not submit a complete application for building permits until February 26th. We have had them 5 days, not 2 weeks. And our standard review period is 14 working days for commercials.
That's all I need to know.
West side.
That's fine. I know there's more to it than the two sides.
Frank, jump right in here. Okay. So we touched a nerve. Okay. All right. So we'll get a response. All right.
Sure.
Okay. Dr. Whitman.
I just would like to thank, I hope you all see my pin. This is from the Walkability conference that we had Saturday. And I really want to thank the city for supporting that. Bob and Ann and Pamela and everybody was there. And it was really a great session. And I hope that more of you, I hope there'll be a presentation to council about some of the suggestions that citizens had for this. And this is not sponsoring walks. This is sponsoring making our city walkable so that people in their daily life can improve their health and their well-being and make our city more livable. So it was a very exciting conference. And they spent their long Saturday afternoon with us, and I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Terry. Anthony?
What? Anthony, he called your name.
Okay, wait, don't.
We might be out of here by 5. You never know.
Great. Tommy, anybody want to mention the Lake Taylor girls are going for the next state championship?
Let's mention the
Lake Taylor girls.
Okay, Mr. Riddick, you have anything you want to add?
Yeah.
And by the way, Andy will not be here.
Okay. Yeah, I was, a couple of times I've mentioned, and nobody has asked me to, a stipend for the Planning Commission. We're the only city in the state that doesn't give our Planning Commission any type of stipend. And they work hard. And so I think that's something we need to really, really consider during this budget cycle. Because we ask a lot of them, and I just think there's something we should do.
The state probably has some guidelines about what you can pay.
They are. Commission. Just like they do for the school board.
And for us.
Yeah. So, but okay. That's, over in Campusella, Dr. Whitby, there's a lady who wants you to get in touch with them. They're doing a 5K run over there. They know that you're a run person, and they want to give you some type of recognition, and I'll find out.
Me?
You. Can you believe that?
Call it, right? It's a trap.
Can you believe that?
I wouldn't go.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Come on.
That's it.
I put it everybody's chair. Tomorrow, Ron and our consultants are making a presentation at the MacArthur Memorial, that amphitheater, the new one they've got over there. We should have about 50 people. We've invited the Library Board of Trustees. We've invited the Friends of the Norfolk Public Library, those people who really, those folks gave us 25,000, like 25 grand to the Slover. The Library Foundation, if any members of the Slover Library Foundation want to come, they've been invited. We've invited the Planning Commission, Design Review, and of course, all of you and any members of the public who want to come. We'll have about 50 people unless the weather really turns bad on us, I think. But it'll be the up-to-date presentation on some really great new graphics on what as they're beginning to really hone in on what the interiors are going to look like and pick out some colors and the presentation, I haven't seen it yet, but I think it's going to be really, really good. And Brian will be there, and like I said, our consultants will be there. And the fact that the MacArthur Memorial train stop, light rail stop, is really developing nicely. We'll talk about that too. So, anyway, all right, Angela, did you hear?
I'm not seeing a time on here for that one. There's no time on here.
It's
2
p.m.
2.
2?
2. Yeah, it's in the middle of the day, I'm sorry, but that's. Yeah. But we can have the same presentation brought in here. I mean, easily. Okay.
In your package of papers, the Lentz Law Group, who represents First Baptist Church, View Street, they put together a packet. It's about 3 pages, but it basically addressed some of the issues that were brought up in terms of concerns regarding Shepherd's Village. And I just wanted to make everybody aware that was there. A copy of it was submitted to the city manager's office. And some differentiations between some of the comparison properties that they were compared to, especially the House of Prayer, which had a surplus at the end of every year, and they turn money over to the church. Shepherd's Village does not have a surplus at the end of every year, and they don't turn money over to the church, and they do offer asylum. So I know this is coming up the end of this month for vote on our agenda, but you know, I just would greatly appreciate it if you guys looked at the information that was presented to you, as well as the counter argument or whatnot that was also presented to you. And also I spoke to the attorney from them, and you know, their position is that while their original application was not filled out by someone of experience, the facts of their case have not changed, and they do what they've always done. And so when they went through the discovery process after they filed their lawsuit to keep the city from selling their property, which was a reason why they filed the lawsuit, that you know, they found that they were in compliance and that their application had actually been filled out erroneously originally. So anyway, I just would like you guys to take a look at it and consider it when you're making your decision on how you're going to proceed with this.
Okay. One other comment that I wanted to make is, Marcus, at some point we need a presentation on here on this House Bill 2313. That's the transportation bill that I spent a couple hours at the TPO yesterday. And we're trying to come to grips with how this money is actually going to be spent. You know, there are a couple hundred million dollars in regional money, as long as the governor doesn't fool with the thing. Plus, there's more other money coming to us. So some of those projects can be for congestion relief, I understand. And so I know a couple communities are already developing some lists of projects that have just been stalled for years and years and years. So we ought to come in here and, you know, the manager ought to make a presentation to us about, like, Military Highway and a couple of projects there that we have just talked about, and intersections that could provide congestion relief for us. I don't know what the rules are exactly yet, but we got to figure that out.
Paul.
I'm sorry.
Can I ask a question from what Angela said? Can we get a presentation about tax exemptions? You might have done one when you first got here, but maybe update it, because I'm hearing that a lot of cities are now putting moratoriums on tax exemptions just because of the conflicts that it creates with pitting nonprofits versus other nonprofits, and you get situations like this. And maybe it would be appropriate for after this vote, or maybe before, but just what other cities in the state are doing and how they're handling the situation with it. Because I think this situation is making some people uncomfortable. And so I just want to get the facts about what other cities are doing with it. And I did have one other thing I forgot about. People do watch us on TV. And I had a constituent who emailed me this morning and said that she appreciated me bringing up about the Keep Norfolk Beautiful, looking at different areas that could need assistance. And she had suggested, could we have something like the pothole repair online where a citizen could submit if there was a fence that was broken or something, that they could report an issue like that, not a code issue, but just a city property where they see something to assist the city with finding these issues faster than waiting for somebody to see it. But just a simple
report. So I think Norfolk Cares, you couldn't call in for that?
Yeah, but they wanted to do it online, not call somebody. Oh. And
well, I can guarantee this wasn't planned, but on the 19th, uh-huh. We plan to make a presentation to council just on that.
Okay, great.
I was going to just say that...
thank you, sorry.
As relates to... We talk about having these work sessions. I mean, we're right back to presentations, you know, and issues like what Angela brought up, as well as a lot of other issues, schools. At some point, I hope we get around the table and have work sessions opposed to presentations, because we don't get to weigh in a lot or get to have a healthy discussion about these issues, or and along with those issues, what should our posture be going forward, whether it be schools funding or, again, exemptions, moratoriums, or whatever the case may be. We were brought in a presentation last week, and we didn't get to an opportunity to absorb it. I frankly didn't think it was a presentation, but at the end of the day, it was brought in. And we come back the following week, which is supposed to be a work session, and councilpersons still don't have the information that I think is important for them to make an informed decision. And other than giving them a spreadsheet, it's a lot more information that they need to be able to make an informed decision as relates to the people that they represent in the city of Norfolk. You know, just coming in here and just getting presentation after presentation is somewhat redundant. We at some point, we got to sit down and have meaningful discussions about issues that are relevant to moving this city forward. And again, funding, education, and issues like this are truly important. We're going to have a couple of presentations today, then we're going to go on, and then we got to ask ourselves, when will that stuff be scheduled for us to have a discussion? This is going to come up, and it's going to be time to vote on it. We're right at the door of budgets, and we're talking about building schools or things like that. We haven't had that discussion. If we're going to have a joint meeting with the school board to talk about what they need, we talked about them putting everything on the table. If I make a decision as it relates to a tax hike, I want to know the impact that it's going to have on the school system, that I'm going to get a bang for my buck, that by doing this, that we're going to see a turnaround, that we're going to see test scores going up, we're going to see, in terms of technology, all these things that are important, that we're making decisions that are relevant to that. But without having those discussions, I don't think we can get there. So I would hope that, you know, in the coming months, that we're going to have work sessions. Or if these are not supposed to be work sessions, let's not call them work sessions. Let's call them presentations.
To piggyback on what you're saying about education, when is the last council or school board discussion on the budget? Is it the 19th of March? Do y'all know?
They're meeting today.
No, I know, but it's one of many. They're having several other work sessions. I know April 1st, I think, is when they present their budget. I'm frustrated that we've got other things now that are coming up on this March agenda, and then we're in April. And when are we going to sit down and talk with the school board about what they need to bring this school around? And I just I've asked this every year, and I'm going to keep asking it. But it seems like we need to have a discussion with them. And if they can't all come, let's not just keep delaying it. Let's move ahead on this. But I want to hear from them. If our schools are not doing well and they're trying to turn it around, they've got a five-year strategy, I need to hear from them. We all do. Of what it would take to get there. How many literacy teachers, if that's it, or math specialists. But we're not getting that. And we're not having that discussion. And it's very frustrating. Nothing counts more than this. Nothing is bigger on our budget. And Anthony's right, if we're talking about tax increases, to not figure this out before we get to May is difficult.
Not only that, we got three schools that could possibly be taken over by the state. I mean, we need to know. There were meaningful discussions at the state level this session that was relevant to three of our schools. So out of that, what is the result? Where are we? And so I think we need to know that as a body. I think that's critical to know. We don't want our schools to be taken over. And so if there's a plan in place to be able to get these students what they need so they can be successful, I think that plan somehow incorporate us, because at some point there's funding issues that need to be addressed.
Now, I know Paul's explained to me, and I've heard from others, that perhaps what the revenues are on the schools is not what it'll end up being. But we can't get so short-sighted that then all of a sudden we're scrambling at the last minute and figuring out what issues. If you look at the presentation by the school board on their budget, it has a very nice graphic about what that budget does not do. And the only things it does do that are positive on education are more AP testing, not AP classes, not AP teachers, and paying the remainder of the 2% school. It does not restore the literacy teachers we lost 2 years ago. I mean, you go right down that list. It's a list of about 15 things.
Well, the other thing, too, is that in the article the other day, they're saying now the federal impact aid checks might not be delivered to the school districts in March, and that the military funding, the extra piece that we get for that, including construction dollars for, is it Camp Allen, might not come through now with the federal budget cuts. And
I'd like to hear from them. I'll stay here until they turn the lights out. If you guys want to talk about education, it is the fifth thing. It's the last thing on the agenda. You want to do that, because we won't get to the scope presentation, because there are a lot of good things that we do, I think, for the schools as well. And so, we can talk. Everybody can ask for as much information as possible. But if we can work through this, at least what we've got here on the agenda, then come to education, we can spend as much time as you want. Ask the manager for things that you want back. We'll schedule a presentation tomorrow if you want to come in, or the next week or something. It's just a matter of how much time you guys want to commit. It isn't a function of how much time the manager wants to commit. It's really us.
I don't know. Thanks for offering that, but I don't know how good it's going to do if the school board members aren't sitting at the table. We can get a presentation today. I know there's a plan for that, but I think we need to have a bigger conversation. Yeah. That's not a presentation from them, a conversation.
Okay.
All right. We need to have a frank, honest, open conversation.
Well, right now, they're trying to decide among themselves what their budget should look like that they're going to present to us. And maybe once they've got that budget, is that moment when we should sit down and have the conversations about what they've got in their budget and what else, they'd like to see. Typically what the city councils do in Virginia is that, we appoint school board members or they get elected, and then we fund their budgets. We don't I mean, they'll give us a, you know, an invoice and says, here's what it's going to take to fund our schools, our, and we decide whether we can fully fund it or not. Typically, almost every year, we fully fund it. And I think I'm the only one at the table who has said publicly that they're willing to support a tax hike for the school system. But I've looked at a bunch of facts, too, which, and we can do this at the end, but, I mean, we are, our teachers are paid fairly. They could be paid better. Our classroom student-teacher ratio is pretty good to compare to everybody else. The number of students in our school, in our various schools, leads the region by with the fewest in there. We got more buildings. Our per pupil payments is right. It's at least the most recent data is pretty good, a second or third. There will come a point when you have to say, you know, really, maybe money's not just the end. Maybe it's not just money. You know, I mean, so, I mean, but we can have that conversation with the school board. But I also want to get to this notion about these schools and the how beat up some of, how badly in need of repair are some of our, some of the buildings. So let's,
I guess, let's, Paul, what I was saying is, you're right. They're having, they've set up several meetings that they're doing. They're doing the public meeting tonight, and then they've got several more work sessions. We can't wait till they're done and then say, oh, yeah, by the way, let's set up a meeting. We've seen that doesn't work. We need to start setting that up now so we get a date secured so that when they've decided together what's important for them, we can immediately sit down and talk with them. That's all I mean.
And you've changed the budget. The hearing is going to be earlier, possibly?
It's early.
Right.
So we have more time for these types of discussions.
But if they're going to present to us on April 1st,
they have to submit the budget.
They submit to us, and then our public hearing on just the budget's going to be in the middle of April.
Well, that's what the plan we presented to council. Ultimately, you'll decide what that schedule will be. But the premise was that we wanted to present the budget earlier than we did last time and give you more time to deliberate on.
Are we going to sit across the table from them before that happens?
I hope yes.
You know, before we get to that point, you know, like I said, you and I met with them last year. And, you know, one of the things I'd ask Kurt and you, I said, look, don't, you know, put it all on the table. You know, don't just put, you know, don't assume that this is what we want you to do. You've cut programs that we had no idea that were cut. You know, and so we can't make an informed decision in terms of what you need unless you put it all out there. And so I've asked, you know, like others have asked them, look, let's put it all on the table. Let's get a real snapshot of what we need. You can't talk about being a world-class educational system if you're not willing to put everything on the table. You know, and they have not put everything on the table to allow us to make informed decisions as it relates to programs that are critical. They had a program, a middle college program, that allowed families, you know, in these trying times to get 2 years of community college under their belt and then just need 2 more years of a four-year institution anywhere to have a four-year degree. That was an important program and helped many families in this city, but they cut it. And so those are the types of things that I think that are important. If we're trying to entice families to send their kids to Norfolk Public Schools, you know, and not private schools, then those are programs that are critical to our success. But if we don't know that they, one, exist, or two, that they're cutting them, and they're cutting them because they're saying they don't have the money. Well, we didn't know that was a program that you cut. So if you put everything on the table and tell me what it is what it takes to make us whole, and then we back out of it that way. But to just not know and then say, well, we need $3 million or whatever the case may be, or, you know, $3 million and we're going to be whole, and that's disingenuous of them because that's not the big picture. And I just want to get them around the table and better understand, what is the big picture? What are your goals in terms of moving these young people to being successful?
But And I agree with you. And they had a slide in their presentation that showed everything that's been cut the last couple of years. But what we don't need is for them to come in and do what you just talked about earlier is a presentation that shows all this fluff stuff that's going on. This needs to be real conversation. And we can be presented to the death on everything that they're doing. That's great. But they have a 5-year strategic plan. They have 5-year. They should almost be telling us where they want to be, how much money they need to get to that for the next 5 years.
Exactly.
Yeah, but they're doing things on a year-to-year basis, and they're not. And I think that they're. I don't know where it comes from. But there's some intimidation that they don't want to ask us for what they need.
I don't think there's.
Not in a negative. It's just. It's just. There's a disconnect between us. We didn't even get the presentation. I mean, that's.
I mean, okay. I mean, the state has backed out $20 million over the last since what 08, 07. 07, $20 million. You know, I mean, that is, 12 cents, 12 or 13 cents on our tax rate to just to keep them whole. And we've backfilled $10 million of it. So, I mean, it's not like we haven't, like this council hasn't done everything it can. I think we're the only city in Hampton Roads since 07 who has not cut funding to schools. And we just went through a terrible recession. So there will be... I mean, there are some cost implications into all of this. That's all I'm saying. You know, so they can tell us they need all sorts of things, and then we'll just have to decide what we can afford. I mean, part of that is that issue. That will be in our lap then.
Okay, so we're going to schedule a meeting with them before then.
Sure we will. Yes, I think that's what the council wants to do.
Just one thing, and I'm all about education. They also got to convince me that they're doing the most efficient job with the money we're already given.
That's why we're going to have this talk.
That's why
I'm not sure that we're there yet. I'm hoping with the new.
But that's why we got to have that conversation.
Right. But I mean, we could give them $100 million more, and
I don't want
to
throw money.
If they don't use it right, we're not getting where we want to go.
Exactly. I don't want to throw money.
I don't think we open the checkbook without being sure.
Exactly.
That we've got an efficient, well-run, plan, because I'm still not sure we're as efficient as we should. In fact, I'm relatively sure we aren't.
I want the money to be tied to results, bottom line. I want them to tell us what they need to be successful, and then we're able to evaluate that from a yearly basis. I just think that's important. Taxpayers should be able to get a year for their dollars. They should be able to see progress with the dollars that we utilize towards education.
I want it to be efficient.
What I'm going to present to you today, City Council, City Manager, Mr. Mayor, this is a concept plan for what the potential is for scope, the plaza, in the future. There's nothing for you to really do today except take a look at this and with a critical eye, see if it's something that makes sense. There are many steps we have to go through to get to the end game, but we've been working on this for about a year now with architectural firms, and we thought it'd be a good time to update you on where we're at. some background. Scope, Chrysler Hall just celebrated their 40th anniversaries. We've made a lot of improvements thanks to you and funding you've given us over the years to take care of a lot of the physical limitations that existed previously, although there's still many there. Rather than piecemeal this year after year as part of that capital budget, we wanted to master plan this out. We did something similar, some of you may recall, in 2004 when we had Ellerbe Beckett look at scope and what we were going to do to the building back then. That was the background for a lot of these changes that you see that we've done over the past 10 years. Scoreboards, lighting, new rigging grid. By the way, like shows like Elton John, Bob Seger coming up, Rod Stewart, we wouldn't have been able to do those without this grid. Replaced all the seats, all the dashers for hockey, dashes and glass. We've added new dressing room spaces. In Chrysler Hall, restrooms were all upgraded. We added restrooms up to the balcony level, sound, rigging, show power. We've done a lot of really good stuff to both these buildings. So we've,
and that's over like a 10-year period?
Yes, right? Sir. We've addressed many of the functional issues. Now we want to move out to the inside the bowl area, inside the seating bowl area in Scope and Chrysler Hall. We now want to move out to the concourse and the plaza areas of some interior, some exterior. Some of the basic needs that need to be addressed, especially, we're talking about Scope now. Women's restroom capacity is way under what current code is. Food and beverage were stretched out in the current configuration. We want better access to the plaza from the garage level. Currently, there's no elevator. If you're a disabled person and you park in the lower level of the garage, you have no way to get up to the plaza. And access to box office facilities. What we did in looking at this, we wanted to entice multiple architectural firms to come and take a look at our situation here. We issued an RFP in 2012. We got 9 proposals back from architectural firms. 4 were finalists. You can see those 4 there. And at the end of the day, we selected Mosley and Populous. Populous, some of you may recall, broke off from HOK. They were the designers of Harbor Park. They're worldwide sports and entertainment architectural consortium.
Are they local?
They are not. Kansas City. Yeah.
So we had 3 local places. What was that on your list again?
The Mosley
is local.
Mosley is local. Populous is from Kansas City, so they're partnering on this particular project. I'm going to show you some concept plans now. You can just see this is Scope Plaza looking down. You can see light rail line in brown. They've taken that into consideration. Most of our traffic comes up now across from Granby Street, from the light rail station, and across from the Wells Fargo building where the new garage has been built. We have a lot more foot traffic coming in that way than we have in the past. These are just some of their initial sketches and concepts where they're looking at the podium, the entryways, the podium being Scope Plaza, the entryways to that from the street, how the buildings fit in, where we may be able to pick up green space. Green space is something that we've asked them to take a really close look at because we think there's room to add a lot of green space to the plaza that would make it more of a park setting as opposed to the kind of stark setting it is now. So use of softscapes everywhere. This is the initial concept plan that was done probably about 6 months ago. You can see a pavilion in the place of where the fountain was. The main thing I want you to notice in this plan is the outside of Scope is a glass enclosure where we are going to expand the concourse out. We cannot go up because we have a concrete dome there, so it's impossible to go vertical, either up or down. We're below the water table now, so the only thing we can do to expand the facilities that we have is to go outward. So that glass enclosure is really the new piece that I want you to pay attention to. You can see it there in the rendering that it comes out right to the edge of the buttress. So in essence, we pick up about 28 feet all the way around the entire circumference of Scope, 28 feet of new space. And that's where we would add the new items that I'm going to show you in a few slides. To the right is a berm that would be going back. To the right is a berm that's over the existing exhibit hall where we would be able to create an outdoor performance space. The glass on the side of the berm would actually open the exhibit hall up to natural light, so allow us to not only increase the space inside, but cut energy use, which is an important part of this concept. This is the initial plan that was done about 6 months ago. You can see the pavilion on the top of the Scope podium. That would house box office and retail possibilities for both Scope and Chrysler Hall and for our other venues where we do ticketing. So the fountain would go away, additional green space all around. This was the initial concept plan that we asked them to expand upon. So again, you can see the axis with Scope, the fountain, and Chrysler Hall. It's a very symmetrical layout. Now you can see the pavilion with new paving going up to the Scope entryway. Again, all on the axis of the two iconic buildings that are there now. You can see the amphitheater to the right that is along St. Paul's Boulevard with grass berms. We could put a stage in the center of that and have outdoor performances going on while things are taking place inside. We have so much good weather here all year round, almost all year round, that that could be a very functional space. A lot of green space on the plaza. You can see in this concept the exterior colored sections are all brand new facilities that would be added to Scope. So the green, the purple, the blue would be additional concession areas, additional restrooms, especially women's restrooms. But the top in orange, you can see a club area, a brand new club area. This would all be in the upper concourse. Huge amount of additional square footage. We would renovate all the existing restrooms that you see on the interior. All of those are the existing spaces that are there now. We renovate those as part of this process. And then again, you'll see the pavilion on the outs leading up to Scope. I'm going to go into more detail on what that looks like now. So the orange would be a new box office area. We would move box office staff out from inside the garage where they are currently, where people have to drive into the garage to access box office. Everything would be up on the plaza. You can see also the red lines are taking in the views from Monticello, where people would access the buildings. And the entryway to Scope, which is very narrow now, four sets of double doors that go in there. We would expand that dramatically, and I'll show you in renderings how that looks or how that might look if we did that. Yes, ma'am.
On the box office?
Yes.
What about security? I know a lot of people pay with credit cards, but if they're buying tickets, people may come in with cash. And by them being kind of out there, I mean...
I'm gonna show you that in a second. That's a great question. Okay. This is the interior look of the box office. So people would actually come into that pavilion. It would be inside.
Okay.
They would be making their purchases along the counter on the inside. There would be elevators coming up from the bottom of the Scope garage all the way up to the plaza. Again, we currently don't have that.
Okay.
We have no elevators. So you could park your car downstairs, take an elevator up, take the elevator back down to your car, or just take the elevator up and go directly into either Scope or Chrysler Hall out of this pavilion building. So it's a huge addition right now where our box office facilities are almost invisible. You can't see them unless you know where you're going. This is what we asked the architects to come back with. This is actually a second floor to that pavilion building, which would add new office space, not only for our staff currently at Scope, but also for people that are housed in Chrysler Hall right now. Our staff are spread kind of hither and yon, and we could also potentially move our special events staff up here because we would have approximately 10,000 square feet of new space that we currently don't have in the existing building. That's a section view of what it might look like coming up from the bottom of the garage all the way up to the top of the building. It's got a slanted roof. That slant runs from to the left from Scope down to Charlotte Street on the right. This is looking from Charlotte Street or from the Wells Fargo building across.
So are you able to go from the garage straight up to the pavilion?
Yes, ma'am.
By elevator?
By elevator, yeah. Sorry. So this is the initial concept of how Populous and Mosley envisioned this looking, and then this would be adding that second floor of space to that outdoor pavilion area. You can see it makes a fairly dramatic effect on the plaza. Totally different from what you see now. I'll also show you, we're going to be taking down those walls along Charlotte Street in Monticello, currently about 6 feet high. We want to take them down to about 4 feet so that the views from pedestrian access are much more dramatic than they currently are. That would be what people would see in the new with the new design. The glass wall all the way surrounding the exterior, which would also cut down on wind and things when we have performances. This would be the new entrance coming out of the pavilion, a brand new glass entryway, extremely more dramatic than the current look that we have. The canopy that goes from the pavilion into Scope would match the canopy that's over on St. Paul's Boulevard currently, so we're trying to keep the architectural look consistent. That would be somewhat what it would look like at night.
Do we really want to keep the architectural
look? This would be the concourse. For those of you that have been in Scope where you see those pillars, that's currently the outside wall of Scope where the glass ends, those pillars going up vertically. So we pick up so much more square footage. It just adds to the ability for guests to circulate, new concession areas. We can vent the concession areas to the outside air and cook a whole plethora of things that we're not able to offer now because all of the cooking takes place inside and we're very limited by what we can do. So it's not only a dramatic look change, but it's also very functional. And the more concessions we sell, obviously, the more money we make. So that's certainly a consideration. These are just some sketches. This is looking from Monticello, what the look might be. Looking from the corner of Monticello and Charlotte. This is from St. Paul's Boulevard, looking up the walkway that's currently there. That's kind of the exterior look of Scope with the canopy heading to the pavilion. You can see the berms in the background with the glass effect. So that's the concept. Making the assumption that you think that some of the things here, certainly not everything, we're not married to anything in this plan. Okay, this is really what we thought was a pretty neat design, not only from a looks perspective, but functionality. So if the next steps would be for, I would work with Frank to get on the schedule with design and review and the planning commission, let them see this as well, because we are dramatically changing what that initial 1970s look is. So we would certainly, we've got some steps to take before any of this could be implemented. And then making the assumption that there was some approval process, we'd come back to you with costs. Everything would be phased over a period of years. There's no way, as much as I would love to see it, there is no way we could finish this in 1 or 2 or probably 5 years. This is a long-term project. That's it.
John, but I mean, great, but wouldn't we talked about this some time ago about naming rights. With our ability to be able to attract Elton Johns and folk like that, why wouldn't we go out in the market now and see if that's viable? $5-10 million.
We are, as we speak, exploring that possibility. We're going to be issuing an RFP to solicit firms who sell naming rights to do that, not only for this building, but it could be for Harbor Park, could be for Harrison Opera House, it could be for any of our buildings, and just see what the market will bear. But I totally agree with you. That's, in my opinion, found money that we could, that would help support this project.
Where would the funding do we have any concept of the amount of funding we're talking about potentially?
Well, as John said, we would come back with budgets, and I think the biggest thing Councilman Wynn is with the phased approach, what would be important for us would be the restrooms. Not everything that John explained, but that, and he said 5 years, I think we'd be looking at further down the road than just that. But just from an amenity standpoint, even having the MEAC, having an opportunity to do something with that, the inside, the restrooms. And that would be, I think, in a significant funds just in that, several million dollars.
What have we spent thus far in planning?
Planning?
Design.
About $280,000.
And that's paid for from the Public Amenity Fund, or where did that come from?
Yeah, that's a combination of the Public Amenities Fund, and then there are infrastructure funds that, that are related to our cultural facilities, yes. Not the general fund.
What study prompted this?
We've been talking about this for some time.
When you say talking about it for some time, just remember that there are only council, there's some council members that have only been here for 2.5 years, okay? So when you say 10 years ago, you could have talked about it.
That's about it.
So I'm asking for 10 years ago, things have changed. The pavilion has grown. Hampton has a new center. I'm asking about the need, if we're going to build a 50,000 square foot convention or conference, I'm looking for, why are we doing this? What is there something that says that we're missing a market here? We had the little waterside thing, but you know, I've heard through sources that the pavilion out at Virginia Beach gets 6 to 8 big events a year, but the rest of them are being, the rest of their time is being filled with the market that we're trying to attract. So are we just competing with Virginia Beach to try to get that niche market of here? What, why are we doing all this all of a sudden? Why, where is this coming from? What have I missed in the 2.5 years that there's such a great need to try to attract? I've talked to Tony, and I, wasn't there a presentation recently that they showed that we actually, hotel beds were down last year?
No, in fact,
the money that was coming in from that. I'm wondering where the big study is that says we're missing this big piece of this market to attract events and things. We are getting Elton John, that's great. Then who are we missing? Who are we not getting because we don't have a facility? It's kind of like we did a design, but I haven't seen a study or anything that says what we need, and why we need this.
Sure. John's the professional, but let me take my best shot at this. Had we not made the investment that we did over the last, let's say, decade for some of the lighting and the rigging and the scoreboard, the city would be that much further behind in getting the business that we do get. So he listens to the consumer, and some of the issues that we have is that the experience, and the experience with having to wait in long, long lines with restrooms takes away from the amenity that we have. And John, if I mess that up, you tell me. But that's
I understand the bathroom need. I understand that. But in a well-managed government, okay, there's benchmarking, I guess. So are you saying 10 years from now you want to attract a certain amount of events at Scope or the hotel convention? I'm trying to figure out, because if we do all this, and you know, I'm hearing the conference market is down. That's what I've heard from different sources. But if you talk to the people who are in that that want to bring it in, they're going to tell you, no, we're not getting enough. We're missing out on opportunities. I want to know where that analysis is that says that we should be spending all this money to do all these projects to attract people to our downtown because we're missing out on it. That there's, you know, the pavilion wasn't expanded at the time, probably when this was first brought up there. I'm not saying I'm against it. I just want something to be able to go back to my citizens, the citizens in Ward 5, because that's who I primarily talk to, and say to them, we have to invest this money because we're missing out on all of these opportunities. We're missing out on these that are going to bring in more dollars. Not saying, well, we could have done it if we didn't do this. I want to know where the projection is that says that if we do this right now, we're going to bring in this amount of money. And
I want to take a crack at it.
And it's like, if you build it, they will come concept. But I think we've got people that are smart out there that can tell us what's going to come if we build it. And I want to see that.
Let me say this. You know, some years ago, we explored taking off the top to see if we could retrofit that facility into a 22,000-seat arena. John would tell you a lot of the concerts that we miss out on pass us and go to Charlotte, to Atlanta, you know, from D.C. right past us. And we had to do something to be able to cap. We were never in, as it relates to the scope, we were never in competition with the beach and those other places. They're not in competition with us simply because they do not have a hockey team. They do not have an arena where they can hold tournaments for basketball, whether it be high school or college. What we tried to do, and you correct me if I'm wrong, Mayor, there was always a goal to go after those events, those tournaments, to be able to bring them in the city. And the residual income, not just the using the scope, the money that's created in and our downtown, the goal was always to bring people into our city. And that's a mechanism to bring people into our city. I always thought that if we could get, whether it be the CAA, the MEAC, or whoever, that we can grow with those folks and we could take that revenue and churn it and use it to help do some of the things that we need to do and not have to use the dollars from the general fund or anywhere else. And so it pays for itself. But I think that, in my opinion, I don't think we are aggressive enough in doing this. The sooner that we're able to do this, you know, then we'll be able to, again, house more people, bring more people. And if he's able to get that concourse, you know, to be able to add more seats in the venue, to be able to add more restaurants in the venue, that only helps us. That doesn't hurt us. We wouldn't have never been able to get an Elton John or some of the other concerts that we've been able to bring here. Keep in mind, Virginia Beach, you say 8 concerts. But that's seasonal.
Not concerts, 8 events.
Okay, 8 events, but that's seasonal.
Big events that fill it up.
Right, but we have the ability with an inside facility that size to go summer, spring, winter, and fall. Okay, so we're not held by a certain number of months to be able to draw people in. But we also got a hockey team that last year was very successful and was selling out. And we didn't have enough seats to put people in.
I don't disagree with you. I don't disagree with you. But you're telling me things that we already know. Because we've seen, we know the Admirals are successful. But I want to know, if we do this, will we get more bodies in there to see the Admirals games? Will more people go in there and see it because it's a nicer event? Where is the study that says by putting money, 11, whatever the newspaper report, I don't even know how accurate that was, all this money into this over the 10 years or 5 years, are we going to get that return back?
Yes, we are.
You're telling me yes.
I would tell you
yes. I just want to know, the market has changed in this area because of some other venues. You had just had Virginia Beach talking about building a basketball arena that was going to have concerts too in it. Will that steal away from what we wanted to do? I just wanted to see I want to see the experts say to us, that we're missing this right now. We're going to bring in X amount of dollars if we do this.
When we did the improvements that we just made, the scoreboard, the big jumbotron, the seats, you know what? There are more people coming to the scope today. Correct me if I'm wrong.
So the cruise terminal that we spent all that money on.
We're not talking about the cruise terminal. The scope right now.
I'm just telling you.
Okay.
We spent all that money.
We're talking about the scope.
I know, but I'm just telling you.
Stay with me. We're talking about the scope right now.
All
I'm saying is,
if you build it, they will come.
What I'm hearing is that you made these renovations, and they've done great.
Right.
And so you've brought people in. So where's the argument that you need more renovations, other than bathrooms, especially for women? Show me. I just want to see the data. I'm embarrassed that I'm being called by the newspaper and saying, "Oh, what do you think about all the renovations?" I'm going, "What renovations?"
Are you bothered by where the money will come from, or are you bothered by the renovations?
I'm bothered by the data that tells me, and Anthony, you're a great guy, but you're not the expert that I'm going to listen to say, "Trust me, we're going
to
make money on this."
I'm not
analyst to put up there and say, here's the deal.
I think we're entitled to that. But I'm sorry about the fact that the newspaper wrote an article without seeing a presentation. Okay, I mean, we had it on our calendar last week and we didn't get to it. My guess is, and Jill is sitting over here, that the newspaper already had that space budgeted. So she's asking us, about what do you think about the renovations this is the first time I've seen the presentations. She had to have something for Sundays or Saturdays or I don't remember which paper, for her paper. And so that's, you know, so she's asking us, what about scope? And, you know, we're all trying to sound like we're, you know, like we're supportive of the administration, but I mean, you know, we hadn't seen it. The thing that look, we inherited this facility, okay? We can't pretend like we don't own it, all right, like it or not, okay? And we can't, they built it in such a way that you can't lift the roof, you can't, the thing that would really help us are boxes, suites, the types of things where a lot of these acts are now going down the road, not just to Hampton or, but I mean, going to Old Dominion. Because, I mean, there is a market changer. But this is a facility over there which we've been spending out of this, mostly out of this public amenities fund, about $1 million a year basically in maintenance money. You know, the seats were, after 40 years, needed replacing. The lights after 40 years needed just to get up to modern-day standards. The scoreboard, there were much smaller venues. There were high schools that had better scoreboards, and they kept breaking down. The lighting wasn't sufficient. It's not like we have overspent, in my opinion, in scope to get it up, just to keep it up to a sort of standard where you wouldn't embarrass yourself when you sold a ticket. And all I think when I'm hearing here, I think the piece about the arena, I mean about trying to kick out the sides there to put in the, I think that's the most intelligent thing I've heard of at scope in a long time. I don't know what the costs are. We'll have to value that against the study.
Right.
But I think that's information we should have. The rest of the stuff, you know, we'll see how, if we can afford that down the road. But the coming out of an event in scope right now, whether it's the tattoo or whether it's, you know, the circus, the long lines at the bathrooms, the people bumping in, were shoulder to shoulder. There weren't enough facilities in there to buy, you know, Cokes and food. If you can just push it out there and we can do that nice and do it in an attractive way, I think that makes a lot of sense. And don't think for a moment we haven't gotten this money back. It's not like just we spent $11 million and we didn't get anything to show for it. We got lots of events in there that we would otherwise would have gone someplace else, especially with the new rigging for the lights and for the,
absolutely,
right? And for the, you know, so a lot of this money is coming back to us. It's not just directly, I mean, the thing that you're also going to have to try to quantify is the spinoff benefits. I mean, we have a restaurant industry out there that would not do very well and maybe would be cannibalized if we turn the lights off and scope. So it's a question, but I think the questions are serious questions, but I'm glad the administration is looking at this stuff seriously. And so we haven't agreed to budget anything. We've budgeted this stuff over, budgeted it a year, every vote a year for a year at a time. We've all seen the money going in sort of small grabs in the scope. But the newspaper made it sound like we had this huge monster plan. I like to dream big, and now we'll see what we can afford and what it's worth.
And I don't think you even necessarily have to quantify the effects outside of it. If an expert came in and said you're going to get 10 more concerts out of this, I mean, you can figure out what the impact is going to be in general from all those people coming in. I just would like to see that. I'd like to see what else we're going to bring in. And maybe it's out there. Maybe the study's been done. John, you do a great job. I mean, it's out there. I mean,
but hold on. Here's the thing, though, is you can get experts. It's like court. You can get an expert for the defense. You can get an expert for the prosecutor. I mean, and one says it wasn't blood, and the other one says it was. I mean, you can get experts. But if you go to other cities and you go to entertainment venues and you go to other nice cities, like Norfolk is a nice city with good food and great shops and quality downtown and all those kinds of things. And I know we have like a bazillion other needs, you know, it's like we always have more needs than we have money for. But a quality entertainment venue, there was a time that scope was horrible. It was awful. You know, and now it's been improved. The bathroom lines are still really long. But it's been improved. But in order to continue that, you know, it's like buying a house and living in it for 20 years and never renovating it. And saying, oh, it's fine because we bought this furniture. It was the top of the line. And
well,
nobody's talking about renovation. I'm seeing plans for a pavilion. I'm seeing plans
right.
for berms.
It's upgrading,
I mean,
it to
yeah.
keep
Marcus,
us.
That's
Marcus
all I'm
runs
upgrading.
A data-driven city. I want to see the data. I haven't seen the bathroom study. I mean, I've been there. I've been there and I've seen.
Sure. I can tell you the line is
wrong.
Well,
okay.
I'm the study. The line
I think
is
just keeping it relevant.
It's always been a city of plans. we just finished the 2030 general plan. There are things on that that we may or may not ever see. I have no problem with planning, getting the details, and then moving slowly when we can afford it, when it's appropriate. I think when we got his article in the paper about all this money, and she called me, and I said, I haven't seen it. I don't know. You know, scope needs work, whether we do it now or later. But to have a plan, there's nothing wrong with the plan. I don't think anybody's asked to come in here and make a commitment to spend any money except for the plan. And if we move slowly once we get the data and the details and move towards it. And that's what we've always been in this city from the 60s and the 50s on, is plan, and this is a plan. And this is something that will be tweaked, maybe changed, maybe never accomplished, maybe accomplished faster. But I don't think we jump on our staff and management for being progressive and thinking ahead, and I think they're right on to bring it, and then we have to get the facts that we need to make the decision based on that.
I agree with you. I think they are great for thinking ahead. I absolutely do because they have to be the ones that keep us on the cutting edge. If scope or any other of our facilities drops to, you know, below substandard level, we're the ones that
we don't want to be reactive. We want to be proactive and then ready to go. If and when it becomes the right time.
If we have data that shows this. That's all I've
been saying. They're not asking for commitment.
I'm not asking for commitment. I think it's a great idea.
We're thinking in the future.
When you come to us in the future, you also show us, because there are experts, Angela, and we listen to experts for Waterside. We're listening to experts for the conference center.
So there are experts.
But our city is making plans based on expert advice.
Well,
and so we can do that. That's all I want.
It doesn't scare me to plan for the simple fact, I said, just like I told Jill in the paper, that, you know, as it relates to financing these projects, you know, I said the first thing we do is go after looking at naming rights. I don't think we do this on the backs where we take the money out of the general fund. I think that you look at other ways to finance this. As long as it's not adversely affecting the pocketbooks of the citizens of this city, I don't see a problem with us moving forward. If we got $10 million for naming rights from the scope, I don't see a problem with them starting the renovations.
All I'm saying is,
I don't see a problem with that. I don't see a problem with us bringing basketball tournaments, whether it be the CAA or the MEAC or whoever, and taking that opportunity and turning that money around and putting it back into the scope. Okay, I don't see a problem with that. But at the end of the day, I think that with all the other things that we have on the table, that this does not jump in front of some of the other projects that are more pressing to get done.
I don't think they're asking for that. They're giving us a vision.
Right.
And we're going to work towards accomplishing
it. Yeah, but we need to get it done.
And we shouldn't be beating up on everybody for thinking.
Nobody's beat up on anybody. We're asked questions, Barkley.
Well,
you know what? And there is a perception out there, once again, that we are spending a lot of money in downtown. And when you run an article like this, whether the pilot got the information or not, people start asking, when are you going to start spending money on schools? When are you going to start spending money on education? When are you going to start spending money on neighborhoods? We don't have curbs and sidewalks in East Ocean View. I'm just telling you, it's a perception. There's a lot of money that's being spent downtown. And whether it's going to happen or not, there's a perception now that there's something out there. And so people see these pretty pictures,
so we're saying this
and they think we're going to spend the money.
Nobody's asked for one penny.
Tommy, I appreciate that. And I know where you live, and I know that's a lot of people believe that. The evidence, the overwhelming evidence, is that when you invest in these sort of economic development projects in downtown, or whether it is housing, or whether it's retail, or whether it is a conference center, or a commercial base, downtown is spinning off millions and tens of millions of dollars that are being used to support things like education and neighborhoods. We shouldn't set up this fight between what's happening in downtown, because downtown, and I know there's a balance.
It's perception, I told you, Paul.
I know, but I hear you, but I mean, we got to continue to respect the fact that some people, you know, believe that our goal is just to build a downtown. Where our goal is to build a city, right? And so what we're getting out of downtown is producing the sort of revenue that we need to pay our police officers and education. We can hear that from other people, but in this long around this council, we got to keep our eye on the ball, which is we're trying to create revenue that'll improve people's, improve the city. I'm sorry, go ahead, Anthony.
No, I was going to say, I mean, you know, we talk about this this perception of, when I got on council 11 years ago, you know, there was no money, literally, peanuts going in Ward 3 and Ward 4, okay? You know, when I first got on council, I believe over $100 million went to Ocean View, okay? Money was still going downtown and we're going to other areas of the city, you know? And we just begun to start building. Barkley jokes all the time about Broad Creek. But prior to that, there was no money going into those communities, okay? And we look at talking about building schools today. We're building a lot. We built a library in Ocean View. We built a library downtown. It could be an argument made that we have not invested in other areas of the city. Literally, haven't invested $1 in other areas in the city in terms of the types of amenities that would allow young people to be successful in the classroom. You know, books in their communities. So I understand the argument. I understand what you're saying. But I've been around this table long enough to understand that, you know, there's still some voids in areas that I serve where no revenue is going into yet. And so how do you fix that? You know, my goal has always been that if you looked at downtown, you said that's the heart of your city. If downtown is successful, then that means the rest of the city can be successful, because that means the rest of the money will flow into those other areas. Now, I'm not saying that there's not challenges that we have to overcome in terms of individual wards, but I think that's why I say, in terms of coming around this table collectively and having healthy discussions about what's important, you know, not just for your ward or my ward, what's important for the entire city to move folk forward. That's why we talk about it. We got this poverty commission now, you know, we got we just added that to end poverty. But yet we're dispersing people from one area of the city to another area of the city. And so all of those things, again, in terms of coming around the table and having real discussions about where we need to target our dollars, you know, opposed to just saying that, you know, we're spending money here, we're not spending money here. I would hope that one day we could have a meeting where we address, we haven't had the meeting about poverty yet, about the various communities. We had a preliminary discussion about the people in Denby Park, where they're going. I've heard some things as it relates to that, but I still would like to know, again, where those people are moving to, whether they're moving to high census poverty tracts or otherwise. So those are types of discussions I would like to have. So just saying that Ocean View is not getting this, or this community is not getting, or Barkley continues to say what he says, it's ridiculous.
But we do have priorities.
Well, we all cut you off.
We do have priorities. We voted on
that. We'll give you more money if you don't talk quite as much.
Okay. Thank you for the scope renovation presentation. But Marcus, Terry and Tommy asked good questions. You know, we want to know what a return on our investment might be there, but also maybe a 3 or 4 pages about, look, this is what we've invested over time. You know, this is what, you know, we expect this to be a 10-year plan or something like that. And first thing we would do is certainly improve the restrooms and the place. And, you know, I think kicking out the side scope would be the, I'd have to see a lot of detail on what you're going to do outside of, sure, in that pavilion and the cost there. That looks pretty expensive to me. But the thing about it would really improve the experience is pushing the sides out there, and they had to add the restrooms, and we might get more, probably get more people in here. Okay.
Mayor, members of council, last week a couple of you asked about the status of the Arts District. It had been since our retreat in September that we'd had some discussion. So the purpose of this presentation is not to bring a recommendation today, but just to give you an update on some of the activities that have been occurring that we will then be bringing to you in April. So we'll touch briefly on background, some of the action to date, describe some of the activities of what's been set up with an Arts District work group, and then what the next steps are. Just as a matter of background, as a reminder, that in 2009, the Virginia General Assembly passed legislation that gave the ability for localities to create arts and cultural districts. And that legislation gave great flexibility for regulatory or incentive packages, including changing or waiving of taxes, fees, permits, or even processes. And in fact, it was actually amended this session as well to add the ability to have different real estate tax rates if the governor signs that. So we'll see whether or not that happens in the next couple weeks. Over the past few years, as we've developed the plan Norfolk 2030, one of the actions that's embedded in our 20-year plan is for the creation of an arts district and the realization that this regulatory changes may be needed to facilitate their development. Of course, you had the discussion with some preliminary discussion about the creation of a district. In parallel to all this, we've actually had interested citizens that have created a grassroots effort and even solidified even to proposing the creation of a nonprofit. If you haven't heard from Jesse and Hannah, then I don't think you have been here. As I understand that they've probably spoken to about 40-some civic leagues or groups or anybody that was willing to listen, including taking walks through the district to talk about what could be in that area. Action to date is that the city manager established a work group. It was established to explore the possibilities for an arts district north of Brambleton and the development of an implementation plan. Ann O'Dell has led this group, and Frank Duke and Catherine Goetz supporting with particular items in that group. We've had, I'll mention some of that activity in just a moment. They also, the manager asked the Norfolk Consortium to look at the ability to generate marketing strategies for the area. We have tasked Urban Design Associates with developing a master plan for the district, looking at connectivity, pedestrian streets, friendly streetscapes, bikeability, and other corridor improvements. The city, as you know, has engaged Team Better Block to create a living charrette that we'll have in April to support the vision that has been discussed for the area. And then we've also been benchmarking against other localities, particularly the ones that have already created the districts based on that 2009 legislation, and actually sat down specifically with the City of Richmond staff to discuss this just last month. The Arts District Work Group has Chrysler Museum Director, ODU Public Art Commission Representative, City Manager staff, planning staff, cultural facilities. The work group has preliminarily established some recommendations that are under considerations for goals, objectives, and the actual district creation. Part of that creation of the district, of course, is where is it? We've loosely discussed where that might be, and this is remains to be on the discussion table that we'll bring to you in April, and that would be that the existing D4 district, which is actually currently called the Downtown Cultural and Convention Center District, that we look at that as the actual district that we would potentially name.
That's downtown again?
The red line represents the entire downtown area, and the D4 is the north of Brampton. Yes, sir. Why that area? Because there are key assets. As we know, we have the institutions of both performing and visual arts with the Chrysler Museum and the Glass Studio, the Harrison Opera House, Scope Plaza, Chrysler Hall. There are underutilized properties which create opportunity. There are existing new businesses that have had different uses than had been some of the history of the past in that district. There's growing support from the property owners that are there, largely generated from some of this grassroots discussion. And then that we have an opportunity to create a unique destination that's really nestled between the downtown again and could connect those two areas. Next steps, we're hosting with UDA a stakeholder workshop for the property owners in the area next week, continuing the, some discussions on what the potential for master planning is with connectivity and streetscapes that can give us a vision for what infrastructure improvements may be needed in the future.
Of course, who from UDA is going to do that?
Ray.
And has he had experience, I mean, I understand his experience in so many ways, but has he had experience in this kind of thing, this kind of new wave design?
He and his associates in particular.
They've done arts districts in the past.
Joe Nickel is actually engaged in Nashville right now, is actually part of the team, and he'll be here this next week as well.
And so he's done an arts district in the past?
whether they call it an arts district or a creative district, it's oriented in that same realm, yes. Right. Of course, you know about Better Block demonstration in April. That will be held there, and that gives us the ability to test out some infrastructure techniques and some vision for what reactivation of those vacant properties could be like. We plan to bring forward an ordinance that would redesignate the D4 district as an arts district. There is a zoning review that has been taking place with property owner input that Frank has been leading, and that needs to move through the process with the Planning Commission, considering that certain uses that you might expect in this district, we can't just do the name it and claim it because, for example, studios or dance studios are not permitted right now by use. So we do need to update the zoning ordinance in order to allow those, which you would think are appropriate, allowable uses for the district. And then lastly, that we want to have an economic growth opportunity here, and so we do need to look at what is allowable and make a recommendation for if there should be any economic incentive package that that goes along with this and what the goals of the objectives of that package would be. When you establish the district by law, I believe that there is a sunset for 10 years, so we would want to look at what benchmarks should be met in the area when we establish that district if it has an incentive package. So we'll see you in April on that one.
Would the ordinance be voted on before April?
We could do, Mr. Attorney, I believe we could do separate ordinances that we, if you wanted to create the district, we also then need a zoning ordinance, which needs to come through the Planning Commission process, which at the earliest could really be late April, and then an economic incentive package. Hypothetically, we could do them in different parts.
Be kind of fun to have it recognized so that it's part of that whole Better Block thing. What about the name? We've seen some controversy that people don't like NOB.
NOB is a place, not an area. And I agree with that, yeah. Internally, we have discussed a knob as a place, and that's Olney and Granby, that intersection. For planning purposes for Better Block, that doesn't really describe an area. We're talking about an area here. So I would agree with that.
So this is Dr. Wibley's art district. This is the one you've been working on.
Pardon?
This is the one you've been working on. You're on that art committee, right?
No.
Aren't you on the art committee? No. Commission or something?
No. None of that. But I'm happy to take credit for it, but no.
Oh. Well, we're in favor of it.
Maybe
we can sell the naming rights to the arts
district. I do think the school is a quality of life for a minute.
Be Chick-fil-A.
That's a Chick-fil-A arts.
I think he has a nice ring to
it. Is that going to turn it around? That art district? Is that we're going to see revenue generated from that?
Absolutely. Interest in people coming to the city.
A study. Is that what you?
Yeah. First, we have to look at that.
I will say I haven't seen a project that's
data driven on this one, by the way.
This is in a while.
Yes. Okay.
Okay, Anthony.
All right, now.
We'll be
at
7 o'clock tonight.
This is a follow-up to the conversation we were having last week that we sort of ran out of time and energy. I just would remind you that one of our colleagues is not here again. I mean, Andy was sick last time, and this time he apparently has had some plane problems. And so... But I know he has some real issues about this. He's mentioned it to some of you. So we need at least to give him an opportunity before we, at least at some point.
Exactly, Mr. Mayor, no vote on any of it, based on my conversation.
He's going to vote no on any of it. We can continue to have this discussion, but I know Andy wants to weigh in on it too, I guess.
Want to postpone?
I don't, when are we going to meet again?
the 19th.
The 19th?
Why don't we get the comments from the people that are here?
The only thing, what I want to do is, quite honestly, up, down, over, sideways, I want to either push it out or I want to get it. I want this discussion is eating up too much of our time for some food trucks. I mean, this is not that hard a thing to come to grips with. So let's. I mean, I'd like to.
Eating up too
much. If he's not here, we're going to have to do it again.
Eating up too much of our time.
Food trucks.
If he's not here, we're going to have to do it again.
So that's postponed.
I don't see where any presentation makes any difference to Andy. He's already made it clear he's not going to vote for it. So why are we delaying this to hear his say no? Well, I mean, he still gets to vote.
Well, because we want to get him to a point where he'll agree to something. We all want to get to a point where we want to agree to something, Terry.
We end up, it's a democratic process. We end up with what we decide to vote on, and we vote on it. And it's either yay or nay, and we count the votes. I mean, we don't, to try to get eight people to, I don't think we're going to get me and Andy to come to a decision that we're both in favor of.
Well, you might. But you haven't had a chance. You haven't had a chance yet. There are all sorts of people getting, go ahead and do it. We'll try to be brief, but we're still going to have to do it a third time here.
We did the whole thing last week.
We didn't most of that.
No. We didn't make
I'm telling you, if you're going to do it a third time, there's no point.
There's some updates based on the conversation last week.
Let's just go straight to the update.
We all
heard it last. Yeah. I think there were some areas of concern about the location
All we're doing is then we'll get on the air next time. We'll do it on the 19th.
Yeah,
we'll come in here at 2:00 in the afternoon.
We've
got a night meeting that night.
Why don't we the presentation's in our Dropbox. Andy can watch it on television. I mean, if he has comments, he'll make them. We're sure of that. So,
why don't we just look at the changes?
It doesn't sound like he's going
to
be
moved
anyway.
Just go to the change.
Okay. Let's walk through a few of these things. The administration would like clarity on whether or not the council would like an ordinance that brings the Planning Commission zoning recommendations forward or not. If you would prefer two ordinances, or separate with this other approach.
There was to open up basically.
Theirs is a zoning based.
I'd like a compromise. Personally, I'd like a compromise proposal.
I would like to vote on the administration's recommendations. You can vote them up or down myself.
Well, but I talked, as I think you all saw, I sent out an email and Ron wrote back and said, we're not making it. Our discussion is purely for you to all have some ideas here and then foster a discussion. So I didn't, from what Ron wrote back to me, it didn't sound like this is what administration wants you to vote up or down. It was more kind of a platform for us than to decide where we wanted to go. Am I right on that?
Didn't we start the whole discussion last time about this is the administration's recommendation?
It is.
That's not what you're hoping.
I thought you did a good job in the framework.
Thank you.
You did.
Come on.
She did a good job.
I know. I thought he was kidding.
We didn't get a reply. I don't think everybody got a reply.
The first time it was clear to me.
I think he just replied to you.
Mayor and Kelsey, helps.
I didn't get a reply.
We do have an administration. The administration does have a recommendation.
Right. That's what I want to hear.
That incorporates some of the items from last week. It was very clear that you wanted to extend the hours on Friday and Saturday and to change the hour at the beginning hour. So we took that into consideration. If Ron could just go through a few slides, I think would be much better off for a discussion for council. Yes, sir.
Okay. As a reminder, we looked at these considerations when we built the framework for what a recommendation could be, or elements of a recommendation for you to react to. That this is an incremental phased approach. That we have great control over the public right-of-way that doesn't give, like a zoning change, a vested right that goes out into perpetuity. That we would recommend that the places that first we start with the public right-of-way and designated parking spaces, and in order to incorporate push carts, we can include sidewalk locations. That you could have future consideration if you wanted to use this incremental approach for adding additional spaces, private property, or even public property through zoning. that the times be expanded beyond the current standard, which we've discussed and we'll revisit here, and then that vehicles, those that are parked in public spaces primarily for safety issues, should be enclosed trucks or trailers that would need to serve out the side, and then we could accommodate push carts in specific sidewalk locations. If you opened up the ability for future private property or public property, then other alternatives for vehicles could be considered as well. So that's the basic framework. Recommendation for places. Again, public right-of-way, places that would be with permits issued through the city administration. So the spots that we're talking about would not be in code. The code would authorize the city manager to designate spots. What we're bringing forward is our recommendation for how we would first implement that. The permits would be issued through a lottery system, and we would prefer to use metered spaces rather than loading zones or taxi zones or fire zones, because with metered spaces, we do have a parking system. We have garages as alternatives that parkers can use versus loading zones where businesses need to use those loading zones and do not have an alternative for the use of other spaces.
Let me just say one thing. As far as your lottery system is concerned, I think that's good, but I think these hot dogs deserve to be there, because for about 3 or 4 years, this vendor has been trying to get a location. So I'd hate for a lottery to take place, and then all of a sudden, she's exempt.
Understood.
And they could never find a place for her anyway, you know.
And there's various ways we can do it. The permit fee, the basic spectrum is feed the meter with the hourly rate, or offset the complete annual cost at $1,000 a year. With vendor and public input, we believe that we should come somewhere in between that, that there should be some recouping of the revenue loss for the spot in order to use the spot, but certainly not the feed the meter nor the $1,000 approach. So that's what we would like to see vendor input. There's all thousands of different ways to do it. You could do it by the hour, you can do it by meals, you can do it for the whole day, and that's what we want to work through.
When do we stop? Do we stop at 6 o'clock feeding meters?
Yes.
At 6 o'clock. 6 or 7. I mean, how inconvenient would it be for somebody to come downtown to do business, and they can't do business because there's a truck there? Parking spaces for people to do business.
We have,
you know, in the city of North,
garages and 150 metered spaces throughout the downtown. So we believe we have ample opportunity for people to park.
But to your point, Councilman Reddick, it would be a predetermined spot. Yeah.
Yes.
Because down around the federal building and the NRHA building and that part of Granby Street, those parking spaces are at a premium. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people would be extremely upset if they came downtown to do business in a federal building and somebody was selling hot dogs.
Agreed. And we're not contemplating that. Then that we could do special events and special events at Scope Plaza, Town Point Park, that we would specify that. So the basics that you see here with the bullets 1, 2, 3, and 4 is what you would see in the ordinance, that authorization would be there. We've talked about north of Brambleton in the Arts District area on Granby at Freemason Street. And yes, there are approximately one closing a month for buses using the Roper Center. But again, we have great control over the public right away. And if a vendor had that spot, we could look for an alternative spot for the few hours that the buses are there. Otherwise,
I heard more that there was difficulty with turning space coming out of that garage. Actually an unsafe area if those spots right there.
We're not looking at the turnings near the garage. It's at the corners. And then at MacArthur Square, Bank Street could be used near MacArthur Square. And then as an example of some of the out of the street right away that a push cart could be used, we do have Plume Street Fountain Park, and we have some others I'll show you some visuals of. There are other locations that keep in mind that proximity of bricks and mortar restaurants, that understand, looking at volume of traffic.
When you said Plume Street Fountain, are you talking about the commercial place now?
Mm-hmm, it's Plume Street Fountain, yes, sir.
It's called the commercial place.
So we recommended six spaces. Is that what you're doing?
Currently, six spaces in the street.
Okay.
parking spaces.
Is that up for four?
No, it was last week's meeting.
That's what they recommended last
week. The issue that was that the two north of Brambleton would not be utilized.
There's only one north of Brambleton.
There are two. North of Brambleton, two spaces.
Two in the arts district.
Can't the market decide that?
Well, it can decide it, but if you want to set it up for failure, you can say, okay, two of these spaces get to be on north of Brambleton.
I don't want to set it up for
but
failure.
But you're only showing one north of Brambleton.
You want to set a restaurant
circle
for failure?
Doesn't mean anything. It's just showing you the arrow.
Two spots?
Yeah, look at the arrow. Tells you.
Yeah, it says, see the printed words? It says two spots, spaces. It's not just
four. Six.
So basically, we're talking about four spots in the areas that there's pedestrian traffic.
They're all in locations that have additional spots right there, so there is capacity to expand. That's MacArthur Square has three spots, Bank Street has four, there's Court Street, College Place has eight, Freemason has additionals, and then up north of Brambleton on Granby, there's a dozen or more. So there's great ability in these locations that have been selected that or nearby that have expansion opportunity.
Why you don't have anything on St. Paul?
On St. Paul Boulevard?
Yeah.
We would not recommend that. Well, there aren't any metered spots on St. Paul.
Well, you got that big parking lot over there.
That's improved property. You would have to change zoning to locate there.
Really?
Yes.
Ron, help me here. If it's a metered spot and the car gets there before the food truck because they have the permit, who makes the car move?
That's some of the details we want to work through based on vendor and public input. What we're contemplating is that we take the meter offline. So it's not just like we read
bag
on food truck bag.
Yeah. And is all of this limited to downtown? What about Church Street and Virginia Beach Boulevard? We have all of that vacancy, the land right there.
Rock Creek. That's not considered downtown.
Yeah, but we got to bring
the zoning districts that allow it are all the green. So throughout the city, we have districts that do allow this use. These specific districts that are in the downtown and zoning districts, it is restricted use. And so we're suggesting to be explicit in with Section 42 amendments.
Show me a district over there by Church Street. You have one over there? If not, we've got to make one.
Frank, do you recall?
Any of the commercial areas?
Yeah.
You're not in that zone.
Church Street.
We're going to get in that zone.
What you mean? Where you want to select? You don't want the food truck?
Church Street.
Do want them over there?
You can have them over there. It's not.
Where's Church Street?
Church Street is right here.
And you can have it there.
You can in any of the commercial areas on Church Street. What you need would be the consent of the property owner if you're going to put it on the.
And if the city is a property owner, then
the city could authorize.
Okay. Now what about up by the zoo and the farm market?
You have very limited commercial areas up by the zoo, which is up in here. You have a little bit of commercial, but you do have commercial up by the farm market.
That would be good.
The only other commercial corridor is at
Burke. It's there.
You can do it right now.
The only other
commercial place you park.
The only reason we're struggling with this is any place that Getz they didn't want them.
You cannot do it in any of our BCOs.
Getz didn't want a town back either, did it?
Any of the pedestrian
to
commercial
out a way
overlay districts.
Do a phased approach. So
any of the pedestrian overlay districts, what?
They're not allowed in the pedestrian overlay district, so they're not allowed on 35th Street. They are not allowed in Five Points. They are not allowed in Ghent 21st Street or Ghent Colley Avenue.
We got pedestrian overlay district in GB's book.
That's not a pedestrian overlay, that's a gateway overlay. So they would be allowed if they could find something in the
wrong coding on that. That would be a pedestrian overlay. That's probably the problem.
Frank, I'm sorry. When I first got on council, there was a lady on Ocean View Avenue who wanted to take a lot that she owned, and she wanted to have food trucks come in on a monthly basis. I think the Civic League had some issues with it because they didn't understand it at the time. But what stops her from being able to do it?
It has to be improved property. You can't do it on vacant land.
Okay.
Because you've got to have it on property where the truck could go on it and would not create environmental issues.
Find another So if she,
and if it is a property that has a building associated with it, it cannot be the required parking for that use. Okay. It would have to be extra parking.
That's a good idea. Mr. Ritt and I used to eat hot dogs over at Tony's Hot Dogs.
Yes, sir.
On an approved lot. It's gone now.
No.
Yeah. It's a shame behind a block, behind a fence.
Yeah, well, the original Tony's is still there.
Yeah.
We missed that. That was a real
problem. He had some issues. People stealing stuff.
That's what it was.
Mr. Murphy, you were correct. Lafayette Boulevard, I didn't mention, also would not allow food trucks.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Based on, we've had discussions about food trucks and vendors and all of the place. They all collectively are vendors. And the ability, if we're not going to take the zoning use change approach, how can you incorporate all types of vendors safely? So these are examples of some of the types of sidewalk locations in the downtown that we would see as appropriate and we can explore more. But basically, where there is sidewalk right away that is wide enough to still allow safe access and walking for pedestrians, make sure it's ADA compliant, of course. But there are opportunities at the Plume Fountain Park on Main Street, or even where we formerly had Atlantic Street going through near MacArthur Square as some examples. And we would recommend that as we take this vendor input, we'll get some sense of how many push carts might be interested in the downtown. But that, you know, we could monitor that with based on a demand for
a bus. Not already on that corner.
Sir?
Someone's already on that corner.
There is one, but there, you know, it's a spot in the right-of-way that is where we have the ability to permit.
Okay,
so that's the places. The times, existing time, Monday through Friday is 6 to 9:30. On the weekend, Saturday, Sunday, it's 8 to 9:30. We talked about a blending. So starting off at the beginning of the week is Sunday, 8 a.m. with a later start time, similar to that already exists, but move it to midnight. Monday through Thursday, keep the existing 6 a.m., but move it to midnight. Friday night, keep 6 a.m., and then go to 2 a.m., Saturday on 2 a.m. We have the one-hour restriction for mobile vendors, which are motorized vendors, so that's food trucks. We would recommend lifting that restriction, no limit. Vehicles, again, enclosed trucks and trailers in the parking spaces. They would have to serve out the side of the vehicle on the sidewalk only. Again, this enhances pedestrian vendor public safety to discourage standing in the street. We really want these trucks or trailers to fit in the parking spaces, and there are many that do. Push carts at sidewalk locations. And then all vehicles, including the canteen trucks that serve out the side, could be permitted when we have street closures, special events, or scope plaza events. Again, examples. Enclosed, this is a canteen truck, this is a push cart. There's some cleanup and best practices of the vendor codes that we're recommending. Require trash receptacles that they have to take with them. Liability insurance. We don't want a whole bunch of external equipment that they put out. No flashing and scrolling signs, no running of power water connections, the vending on out the side, and no external sound amplification. This would be in the ordinance that we bring.
Whoa, that looks terrible.
So this is Farragut Square at a metro stop near the White House. Just as an example, looking for the future. We'd recommend it. Would you like to have a touch it, feel it, see it opportunity? We could have a special event at MacArthur Square in March. Meet, greet the food trucks, something of that nature.
Are you invite all of them?
Yes.
Not just the four or five that I see.
They've had one at WHR.
But there's more food trucks than just that rolling around.
Are you talking about making these spaces available just to trucks that are permitted in Norfolk or all over the region, does it?
Which one?
You got to have a Norfolk permit to do
yes,
this?
You have to.
Okay. Do you know how many food trucks are presently permitted in Norfolk?
There are a lot of vendors that do have business licenses but may not be using them, or they have the licenses because they're under the peddler's licenses and they may be part of the Harbor Fest type of events. But what one one measure I use is how many have the health permits, because you have to have the health permit to operate. There's 33 health permits out there.
There's a lot.
The ones that pull up at construction sites are all permitted through the city of Norfolk.
That's correct. So you need a business license, but do your health permits, sometimes also we give a reciprocal health permit that this department will approve.
I just hope you would go get, whether they be panelers, license that they have, or whether they should have that business license, that we make sure that we make an attempt to contact everyone that is doing that type of business. And so if you're going to do it right. Like I said, one of my issues has been all along that we're all inclusive with this this program.
And that's the purpose of the second bullet. And while we'd like a pause, if this is the direction that council would like to go, this incremental phase approach with the right-of-way approach, and opening up the time some, then we would recommend now that we go through an input session process and bring, hopefully by end of April, an ordinance to you.
I like it.
That's the way I'd like to go. I'd like to ease into this thing. I think it's going to work and be fine, but I think we ought to tiptoe in.
Anthony, Paul, Angela, Tommy, Terry.
Well, you know, obviously, I've stated the things that I think are important for this, and that's what I feel.
I'm okay with it. I wish there was just a few more options for them.
I think four is pretty small.
Location.
I think even, Waterside area, Town Point Park area.
Hey, stop it.
But why can't they have the flexibility that they can move over there around?
They come over there doing festivals, Tommy. They over there festivals.
Just during the work week. There's nothing else over there. You got a little sandwich shop that's has a little lease that Omar, doesn't he do something over there in the summertime?
Yeah.
But why can't somebody else set up a food truck?
This is a phased approach. Maybe we can do that.
For your park.
Fans of the phased approach, okay? Yeah. Anthony, okay. The only reason I think my concern about moving them around, letting them move around, is the concern about sitting up close to a restaurant.
No, I'm saying what we do is we develop areas that go along with what you all have concerns about, meaning not being competitive, and divide those areas, and then they can have at it. They can go to those areas, but they can be flexible, so they can move around. That's the fun part of this. This isn't a stationary, another restaurant just poised in a parking spot. They're on wheels for a reason. And they move because this is a hot area. Something going on here. This is where we want to be. We can still compensate for your all's concern about competition by picking some areas. And they know that if they come in, they put that cover on the parking meter and they can stay as long as they want. But when they're not there, they take that off, so citizens are not irritated that you've got a spot that is dedicated to this place and nobody can park there because the truck didn't show up. Yes. So you've got to be able to make it fun. If it rains, those trucks aren't coming. So why are we wasting spots that could generate money and irritate Mr. Riddick's friends? You know what I'm saying? But, I mean, really. We've got flexibility is what this is about, but we can still do what you want to do, and that is your fear of competition with other restaurants. But make areas. Don't say, you got number two, that's your spot.
Well, that's what they wanted, right?
Huh?
That's what they wanted, right?
What do they want?
I thought they just wanted to be downtown.
They do, but they want flexibility so they can move around to, like, if there's an art exhibit and there are a lot of people there, there's a concert, a music, where people are moving.
And that's what's contemplated.
They're not going to be consistent at the spot that we're appropriating for them.
Because you and I are old fogies, and we think stability is important. For these people, they're tweeting all the time and saying, hey, this is what's happening here, this is what's happening here. This is what is happening, and you got to go with that feeling. You can't make it the same old stuff.
Dee doesn't stay in the same spot. She moves around.
Right, I didn't take that.
I do have kids at Zanesville. He's acting like he's older than me, which is really scary.
Do we have all the cards?
You aren't getting up there.
We have all the cards available. We are not discriminating against cards. last week there was a differentiation between what carts were allowed and what carts weren't allowed, and Anthony posted.
That was the change. Last week I was suggesting that all we were going to use is parking spaces, and because of safety, we would not recommend that a cart be in the parking space and someone standing in the street.
Okay.
And so what we're changing is we're suggesting that we'll add sidewalk locations in the right-of-way as well that we can also permit, that a cart would be appropriate to be established there.
Okay.
Yes.
We don't want anybody to get hit, but we don't want to discriminate against the cart.
No.
What's up with the other cart? I mean, what's wrong with that one?
Again, people standing in the street or just, if it's the will of council, they're on the sidewalk. They only serve out the side of these.
Yeah.
And the canteen truck, most of the preparation of the food is done out the rear of the truck. There's nothing enclosed on that you can work from. So everything is in the street that you're typically doing for that.
You seen Soul Food Gourmet?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Okay. It's a bird.
Okay, we
got to be
but the whole idea is to try to get something by the April, is that what you
said?
Special events.
I got one
sidewalk.
Fresh produce.
Okay.
Collard greens.
All right, thanks.
Burnard Rural can be I mean, you know, if somebody owns a private spot and says, how come I don't have a food truck on my own private property if you guys are allowing
me? What do you mean?
Yes. Yeah.
Look, I asked the administration to tell us, or to tell me what the impact of a 1 cent real estate tax increase for education would cost, and I got this.
The 1.7.
$20. $20. That's 1 cent. Something to tell you that if you want to raise money for education.
I'll test it tonight at the Wilbur Civic League.
I think that's a good idea. One penny costs you $20. If you get a meeting set,
it's the greenhouse crowd. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, you said $20. That's what I'm asking.
So, Paul,
yeah.
That's your...
That's what's that, 1.7 million additional revenue, right?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Unfortunately, I'm out of town, because I would have liked to come, but I appreciate it.
It's 111 now. Yeah. What's 1.7? I mean, really, what is it?
It's kind of 1.7.
No, it's 8 cents a month. Excuse me.
I know, I bailed on it. She and I were going to go together. I didn't do it.
Was it Grey Wolf? Is that where you're going?
I'm not going, but I was going
to. My grandchildren.
Oh, you're off. Yeah.
Okay, we're pushing. Okay, go ahead. Sabrina, we're ready.
Okay.
So, Mayor and Council, this would be, I guess, the beginning of the discussions on education, and clearly we heard what you said earlier. What Sabrina's going to do today, two things. Winter handed out a packet to you. In that packet provides some background information on the left-hand side of Dr. King's proposed budget, as well as some excerpts from the information that we provided to Council at the September retreat. As we go forward, we can, depending on what you would like, we can build a resource book for you so that as Council engages in these discussions, either amongst the Council or with the school board, that you have data. Also included in the packet is, because this has come up several times, the 2007 MGT study that discussed the schools and what schools needed to be replaced or renovated. So this is more or less a background information. So I think while Sabrina has a dozen slides or so, she's going to focus on just a couple of areas that have been discussed around the table, and just provide Council with an opportunity to talk about education and anything else that you would like for us to bring back to you.
Thank you. I think we started off earlier with the discussion about this presentation. The presentation's designed to generate more discussion. But I do want to take one moment to introduce somebody, and that's a young lady back there by the name of Morgan Ramos. Raise your hand.
She is a success story. She is one of our NEL municipal interns that came on 2 summers ago, and we hired her in the budget office. A lot of the numbers that you see are because of Morgan putting them together. So don't blame her if it doesn't go the way you want it to go. If it goes well, then it's my credit. If it goes bad, it's hers. Just kidding. But the purpose of this presentation, again, we'll cover a little bit on revenue sharing. We talked some about revenue sharing, some dedication of revenue. We'll go over about it a little bit. A history on school funding, which you've had a couple of times, and a little bit about school construction. So what we did was we took a look at revenue sharing formulas throughout the state, and I'll tell you that we didn't find quite a lot of them. A lot of the localities did not have them. We did have 4 of them in our region recently, which was Chesapeake, Hampton, Newport News, and Virginia Beach. Newport News, since 2010, fiscal year 2010, has eliminated their sharing formula. Virginia Beach, as of last year, has eliminated their sharing formula. And a couple of reasons for that is in Virginia Beach, since the economic recession began, Virginia Beach school systems lost a total of over $19 million because of the revenue sharing formula. In Newport News, they also lost money, and so they eliminated the formula because they don't want the school system to suffer. So as we talk about revenue sharing formulas and we put a formula in place, just know that in good and bad times, the formula holds. The integrity of the formula will carry us through. There are some pros and cons to the revenue sharing formulas. The pros are, one, if we have one, people have an idea of what to forecast. They actually have a ballpark of what they can expect. It also defines a set methodology for the public that's easy to understand or at least provides them a framework of how it's done. And it can also include a tax increase to support it. Now, the cons are when the formula is in place, it limits your flexibility because the formula holds. And it may not factor in additional factors such as our in-kind services that we provide to schools, like crossing guards and resource officers and our school facility maintenance, our grass cutting, things like that. It also doesn't consider any performance measures. It doesn't consider enrollment. A lot of the formulas don't account for enrollment decreases. So there are, again, pros and cons. And if we establish a revenue sharing formula without adding to our revenue, we are taking away from what is currently there. If we establish a revenue sharing formula and it goes above the 107 that we provide, and we're not creating a new revenue source, all we're doing is taking revenue from another source that we're funding. Okay. So basically, the formula is in place. Other than it providing a good framework and for people to understand, it will limit your flexibility. And so as we looked at it over the course of 2008 to 2013, and just in local support, this doesn't include state or federal funding, this is just local support, you can see Chesapeake, Virginia Beach, and Hampton declined over the years. Portsmouth just didn't have the revenue. Suffolk, Newport News, and Norfolk, who don't have a revenue sharing formula, did not decline. We actually increased. So you had that flexibility to keep the funding flat or increase it. And this is, revenue sharing formulas is similar to what the state with the local composite index a few years ago. When the formula kicked in, all the cities lost money and they did a hold harmless. Again, the integrity of the formula at that point was violated because they didn't hold to the formula. They provided extra funds to support the schools. So if you look at, you've seen this slide many times, this school funding, you know that they're about 38% of our city budget, 62% is all other. They're more than a third of our budget. But we also, what's in that $302 million, and I say $302, I'm not including the carry-forward amount that they did back in the fall of $3.2 million. What's not in the $302 is another $16 million that we provide in in-kind services, and that's crossing guards, school nurses, facility maintenance, ground maintenance, resource officers, debt service, and the school maintenance funds of $3 million, which is in capital. So as we look at the past since 2007. The city has contributed over $10 million since 2007, while the state has decreased support. But also during that same time, we've lost almost 2,700 students in ADM. Now, you know, as you know, the state formula accounts for enrollment, but the local support does not. We don't change. And as you look at the average daily membership, the blue bars are the ADM. As you see the ADM declining, the city support continues to go higher. If you look at ADM for the past, I guess, 10 years throughout the region, Norfolk has lost about 4,200 students, Virginia Beach with 65, Suffolk had a big gain of 1,800. And NPS is projected enrollment. This is from their projections. We are also scheduled to lose another 1,000 students by the end of 2017, starting in 2013. So if you look
do
at the 20...
Do we know where those students are going?
No, we don't.
And why don't we?
We can try and find out, but this
because,
is their...
Because, you know, I think it's pertinent on this. One of the things that we need to understand is, are we losing them because people are fleeing the city? Are we losing them because kids are going to public private school because our schools are not succeeding?
Right, yes.
You know, there's, yeah. Well, so I think that, you know, I totally get that money is, you know, money and kids is important, but you also need to understand money is important with enrollment.
Right? I will provide you, I'm on a committee for Norfolk Public Schools that's looking at the strategic plan, and that's one of the things we looked at. We looked at census data, and the amount of school-aged children in Norfolk, there's a lot of kids that are going elsewhere. Now, compared to other districts, believe it or not, we're not as bad, but we're not capturing as many kids in our public school system as that we could. And there are schools, there are some schools that are struggling now. Ryan Academy apparently had some accreditation issues, so some of those kids are coming back to public school. But the bigger ones like Norfolk Academy and Norfolk Christian are pulling kids away from the school district.
Well, no, St. Patrick's has been huge.
Right.
But if you flipped one of your graphs around, I mean, it isn't just Norfolk. I mean,
that's
it's
St. Patrick's.
But I mean, Norfolk's losing folks. Portsmouth, Newport News. I think there's some sort of, Tommy, and maybe you're thinking, there's some sort of demographic bubble moving through the system. But and at the same time, our population is growing, Terry. So,
school-age kid, are people having fewer kids? I mean, is that part of what you're...
I mean, there's
school-age kids are constant or growing? Or
no, they're about the same. I mean
a part of the answer may be they're deciding to go to private school.
Right,
sure.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure that's the whole answer.
And a part of the answer is families with school-age children choose to live other places where the school systems have...
Virginia Beach has lost significant.
They
have.
Right. Some of these kids are being homeschooled now.
A lot of them drop out.
Yeah. I think a lot of them are
middle
dropping
school.
Out.
Military moves too.
We this is not the first time. I mean, they've been talking about this. We've had a discussion some time ago about where these kids going from elementary school to middle school. Where are they? You have the numbers. And when you look at high school, okay. You know, and so.
Well, and there's an argument to be made that there's a drop off. After elementary school, because middle schools, we've got to beef up the program, which is one of my concerns with the school board's budget, is cutting 38 middle school teachers. I don't know if that's an area you want to cut right now, but we do need to look at programming for middle schools, and I think this administration is addressing that. They want to expand a program that's at Ruffner to another school. They're looking at allowing Rosemont Middle to add more spots for kids so they can keep some of the kids that are there. But
you're talking about the School of International Studies?
International Studies, but there's not really been a study on that. And the hard part is particularly with census data for schools, that private school parents tend to not want to participate in the census because they know that money goes to the public schools and they respond. So there are some people who refuse to say, you know, where their kid is.
All right, so then we can talk about, and again, this is to generate discussion, so you don't have to wait till the end. This is what's in our plan CIP, 2014 through 2017. You've all seen this. But we'll turn your attention to something that's in your packet. It looks like this, and it's about ADM, and average. It says average daily membership and fall membership. And it gives you a breakdown of this one, right?
Yeah, it's page 5-8.
Yes.
Here's our new one.
It's page 5-8 in the office commitment to excellence in education.
Up on top it says average daily membership and fall membership. It has a list of schools, and it has your fall membership by schools. This is what the school system has reported to DOE. Find it? It looks like this.
This one right here.
And then there are some comparisons in here. A few pages later, it also looks at a 10-year comparison of all the schools. So again, feel free to read this as you may want to fall asleep at some time, and you can look at this for your discussions.
Sabrina, we've seen similar charts to this, and I think that it's important because the school system has reported to us what the priorities are for this, and to not continue to put school 3, school 4, school 5. School 3 is Broad Creek, school 4 is Ocean View, and school 5 is Larchmont. And there was a letter that was sent to council that said what the priority was for this. That was sent about a year ago when the school board made an official vote on what the priority was going to be. We just keep on using school 3, school 4, school 5, but I thought that there was a... No, but they voted and finally sent us a list. Before it was hodgepodge.
So what is that?
See up there where it says we have Crossroads, Campostella, and then it says school 3, school 4, school 5. They have already designated what those schools are. And every time we do a presentation, we don't put a name on it. But I think it's important to go ahead and put a name on it. Because it has changed. Right, yes. Right. But that was the other concern I have, too, because...
On what page are you looking at?
No, I'm looking up here on the slide.
I mean, I thought maybe there was a page here.
No, I don't have the letter, but the school board...
My eyes aren't as good as yours. Okay.
Right.
So...
It's not a page. I'm just looking up there. See where it says Crossroads, Campostella, then school number 3, school 4... I'm just saying put the actual name of the school in because they've already told us what they are. The school system has said Broad Creek's number 3, Ocean View's number 4, and Larchmont's number 5. That was the last order that they sent to us. And the other thing, too, is, and I've said this before, that I see the MGT studies here. I think it's important that we look at this. And you can see down there Willoughby Elementary is... 219 students are at that school, and I've said this before, that there's no reason why we're operating a school of 200 kids, and the resources are at that. They have one third grade, one fourth grade, and one fifth grade class, and that's one of the other reasons why Ocean View Elementary was up on the list, and somehow it got bumped, because they were going to close Willoughby and put a new school there that was going to merge Ocean View and Willoughby together. Almost every student who comes out of goes to Willoughby, comes out of the military housing right next to it. And, I almost think that every time this came up, the last time this came up, the military housing folks came and complained that the school was a close-knit community, it's needed because their, dads and moms are out at sea and they need to be together. And I think the comment was made, well, then the military needs to help support to keep that school open.
What grades did you say were in there, 3, 4, and 5?
There's one third grade class, one fourth grade class, and one fifth grade class.
And then there's smaller.
There's only 219 kids.
I asked one of the school board members that just the other day, and they said, well, if they had some place to move the Willoughby kids, they would move, which I guess is the Ocean View Elementary piece. So
right, Ocean View is that capacity. It has 600 kids,
right?
Which is why, like I said, Ocean View was originally supposed to, if you go back to when Dr. Jones was the superintendent, Ocean View was next on the list because they were going to close Willoughby and merge it in. Somehow, the order changed. But those are the types of things that we have to look at. There's a couple other schools up here that are fairly small as well. And it is controversy. There's a lot of controversy when you close a school building. But sometimes the reality is that it's needed. I've said that to the school board, that there has to be, they have to come to us and tell us they're willing to take that risk and close it, political risk, and go to the community and say, we got to close it. And I think Willoughby is one that should be looked at.
I think that I would expand on that and say that City Council needs to take the political risk and understand that fiscally and academically we need to support them in those decisions.
Right.
And I don't think it's school board that's worried about the politics. I think they know that they're not going to get the support always from council.
Well, I see what the enrollments are, but in reality, what are the? I'm curious what the vacancies are. A good example is, let's just, and I'm just saying, if Willoughby Elementary is 219, what could it take?
It's in this document here. It tells you.
Which one is that?
This is the MBT study.
I just got here.
So. I'll tell you in a minute if I can find it.
And I mean, like Larchmont Elementary, 581, can it take up to 700? Are we dealing with that kind of gap? I'm just curious, because that's really where they need to begin redrawing their lines and closing certain schools.
Willoughby's functional capacity is 400.
That's an easy call.
Almost double.
How about Tarleton, 425?
Tarleton's, their functional capacity...
432.
So they're right on.
Yeah, 432. That's on page 80. It's really small. It's okay. Page 83.
I think that's really the... what we have to look at, and I think that's really what the school board needs to look at. So if they can close them and consolidate and do so, get it done. We've got dipping enrollments and wasting money at keeping these facilities open. Let's get it done.
At the time, the MGT study was showing a projected enrollment increase for elementary from 18,000 to 20,000, a 2,000 student increase.
This facilities report is really very updated.
Yeah.
But you could also add that if the quality of the schoolhouse was bad then, you can imagine it's a lot worse now, 5 years later.
Well, I mean, do we have to task them to do this, or are they listening and we expect them just to get it done?
I think that's the conversation we have to have with everybody. We don't get to tell them to close Willoughby. But if we're going to put more money into the system, they've got to say, we're willing to make hard choices for you.
Right.
I mean, so because we want to make sure we did some of this before you got here, that the money's being well spent.
Right.
That's all. And we're entitled to ask those questions. But at the end of the day, they got to make those decisions. But I've never felt like they didn't think they could close a couple schools and not get our support. I mean, I don't know where they were. Seriously.
Are the high schools in
high school? Close a high school.
Where are the high schools?
Tell me there's no bureau.
Okay, right.
Yeah, come on. We need to close a high school.
I mean, Lake Taylor High School is 1277. What's its capacity?
Yeah, the...
okay, all right, so keep going.
Capacity of Booker T is 1386. Capacity of Granby's 1900. Lake Taylor's 1260.
Oh, they're all right on there.
Well, they've got 75% of that capacity. Yeah.
Yeah.
100% capacity.
I got to read this. More views, we could take a few more kids.
Okay, all right.
So all of them could. All of them take another 25%.
Yeah, Booker T is with them.
To answer your question, Dr. Whitley, March 13th is the next school board budget work session, and March 20th is their scheduled adoption date. And then April 1st is when they turn their budget over to the city.
Thank you.
At some point, we need to have an explanation to us about, I mean, I would like to have an explanation about this technology report, this $22 million, I mean, how they, if they anticipate that being phased or what that means exactly. It looks to me like there's a computer for every child.
You say there is?
No, that's one of the...
I mean, should they have something besides... Are these computers, like, at desktop type of stuff, Tommy?
It was mentioned that it was a laptop per kid. They wanted them to be able to take it home. That was my understanding.
The schools
can't... Right now can't handle the... I mean, the bandwidth is, yeah, is so...
The servers can't hold it.
And they need that exposure.
And I don't know, has there been any discussion about updating this report? Has MGT, I mean, was there an agreement in the original contract that they would come back in a few years? And
not that I'm aware of.
I think we'd all like to have up-to-date information, but me personally, I want to get some schools built. I mean, we can get frozen with this stuff about making sure we get all the complete data, but the schools that are built in 1939 and 1929 and, you know, I mean, just intuitively tell me they need attention. So, anyway.
Well, as I've said to Paul, I support him in the tax increase, but I want to make sure that the best bang for our buck is building new schools and not taking that money to provide renovation for more schools that gets them up to date for infrastructure, roofs, bathrooms, windows. And we've all know that a new building is important, but we also know what's really important is moving the academics ahead. And a new building doesn't guarantee that. You've got to have technology. You got to have a dry roof, and you got to have bathrooms. But you may not need to have a new building to make the academics better. And if we can spread it out over 10 to 15 schools, our tax raise.
It'll be like a big old Band-Aid on each.
Not if you did it right.
Well, I know.
The other part to that too is if the academics come up, as everybody else, you know, as well documented, the property tax values come up. The property tax values come up, revenue comes up. Revenue comes up, we have more money to do more stuff. It's a real simple analogy.
Well, one penny basically will build you an elementary school. I mean, so I guess it, Sabrina, what is it? I mean, it gets you about $23 million bonded. So 1.7 will get you a mortgage on a $23 million bond.
We can't even get one school built yet. I mean, hell, by the time we get through planning, we'll be 4 years down the road. We've been trying to get Campus Stella built for the last two, 3 years. So by the time
we're talking about on the
we're on our way. I don't think we've given up on any of that. But you know, it's just a question of will, that's all. I mean, my friends, about, you know, how much money you want to put into this stuff.
Well, it's 18 months to build a school.
Tax credit too for
you got a year of planning. You got neighborhood meetings and everything you got to do.
I mean, that's a year away from building. We've saved money.
You know, but you
get that tax credit from.
Yeah, you had that money in the budget by then.
For a developer. Yeah. And something that it needs to be looked at.
You're absolutely right.
I mean, that's what I want somebody to come in here and tell me. I want somebody to come in here and tell me from the school.
But if you do it, you can do it.
We would need the concurrence of our friends, I think, at the school board. But they've got a very limited staff over at the school system to monitor the construction of schools. Very limited. And we have public works people who can do that.
Bring it over here.
I think we ought to build the schools and give them the keys, and a lot of communities do that. And we've got the people who can do that. And we can probably do it cheaper, and we can do it just as well. And nothing will be lost in the process, but we can save some money, I think.
How do you get that? Whose decision is that?
I think it's since we've who else? Doesn't Richmond do them that way? I mean, how many other cities? There are a lot of cities that do that. They're just because they just don't have the staff, especially.
Can anybody ask John?
John's ready. Yeah, look at him. Kuiper just... But
so
I think,
how do you make that?
And then we can actually get them built.
So why don't we make that decision? And how do you make that decision? Do you vote on it? It's a nod of heads or what?
I think we tell the manager. I mean, I think the PP, anybody who wants to make a PPEA proposal ought to make it to the city, and not to the school. And that's the first step when we move on with it.
Does
that include
the
server maintenance of the building, or would that stay with the school system? No, like if they need a new roof?
For a new building?
No, for a regular building. Are you talking about
I think the maintenance stays with it. I mean, I don't know. We could debate all that.
I don't know why we wouldn't take it off.
I don't know. Yeah.
No, okay. Them have an apartment and us have an apartment. The house authority.
Andy, how's the air out there?
We ought to be purchasing.
That's right.
We ought to be doing it ourselves. We have people to do it. We can reach out and make sure the buildings are done.
For 12 years.
The school system and house authority have to do it. Make no sense.
Okay. Are we done?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. We're gonna schedule a meeting. We're going to schedule a meeting. But take a look at this now, this little thing that's got there. One penny costs the average homeowner $20 over the course of the year.
My library bill.
Yeah. Library bill.
Yeah.
this meeting's done.
I don't, and the sad thing about it, I don't need a vote from it.
It ain't gonna happen.